محمد وآل محمد.
Does everyone have a copy of the Quran? Because we're going to be continuing in our discussion on the tafsir of Surah Maryam. And we left off on verse 27. Surah Maryam is Surah 19 of the Holy Quran. Verse 27. And inshallah, today we will cover verses 27 to 33. And so I will recite in Arabic, and I'd like you to, you know, recite with me. So I'll recite a section of the ayah, and then after it, you'll recite out loud, and then we'll go through the verses. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Okay, now recite along. فأتت به قومها. تحمله قالوا يا مريم لقد جئت شيئا فريا يا أخت هارون ما كان أبوك امرأ سوء وما كانت أمك بغيا فأشارت إليه قالوا كيف نكلم من كان في المهد صبيا قال إني عبد الله آتاني الكتاب وجعلني نبيا وجعلني مباركا أينما كنت وأوصاني بالصلاة والزكاة ما دمت حيا وبرا بوالدتي ولم يجعلني جبارا شقيا والسلام علي يوم ولدت ويوم أموت ويوم أبعث حيا صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. Does anyone want to read the English translation, and then inshallah after that we will begin? Any of the sisters want to recite the English translation? You guys all can read English? You guys know English?
I will if no one else knows.
Go ahead, have no one.
And she came to her people with him, carrying him with her. They said, O Maryam, surely you have done a strange thing. O sister of Harun, your father was not a bad man, nor was your mother an unchaste woman. But she pointed to him. They said, how should we speak to one who was with a child in the cradle? He said, surely I am a servant of Allah. He has given me the book and made me a prophet. And he has made me blessed wherever I may be. And he has enjoined on me prayer and
33.
And peace be on me the day I was born, and on the day that I died, and on the day that I am raised to life.
We left off in our discussion. We left off at the point where Maryam alayhi salam, she gives birth to Isa alayhi salam in the middle of a desert beneath a date tree. And she was apprehensive and she was worried about how the Bani Israel would perceive this situation. She was afraid of their slanderous words. And she was afraid that her reputation would be completely destroyed. But she is directed by her son, according to some narrations, to remain silent and to fast from uttering a single word to any human being. So verse 27 tells us, فَأَتَتْ بِهِ قَوْمَهَا تَحْمِلُ. She returns to her community, the community that she separated herself from, and she secluded herself from in order to deliver this child. So now she returns to Bani Israel, and we know that Bani Israel is a nation that is notorious for that's notorious for being slanderous, that's notorious for being very, you know, difficult, and a nation that has caused a lot of anguish and agony towards many prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is not an easy community to deal with. So she returns to Bani Israel carrying this young child. Immediately when they see this, you know, Bani Israel, they heard stories and they were very well acquainted with Maryam. They knew that she was a woman of purity. They knew that she was a woman of modesty. So immediately when they see this scenario, when they see this situation, when they see the pure and the modest Maryam holding a newborn child, they weren't able to contain themselves. They had to say something. So they say, قَالُوا يَا مَرْيَمْ لَقَدْ جِئْتِ شَيْئًا فَرِيًّا. Oh Maryam, we know that you're a woman of chastity. We know that you're a woman of purity and a woman of modesty. You're coming forward with a very strange and a very puzzling thing. And then they tell her, and you can read it in the translation, they say, يَا أُخْتَ هَارُونَ مَا كَانَ أَبُوكِ امْرَأَ سَوْءٍ وَمَا كَانَتْ أُمُّكِ بَغِيًّا. They say to her, O sister of Harun, your father was not an evil man, nor was your mother unchaste. Now the question is, why did they address her as the sister of Harun? Why don't they just say, O Maryam? They address her as, O sister of Harun. Now the question is, who is this Harun they are speaking about? Many people, many Muslims, they imagine and they assume that, and they have the impression that Allah is speaking here about Harun, the brother of Musa alayhi salam. But we know that Maryam came many generations after Harun, the brother of Musa. So who are they referring to? The commentators of the Holy Quran, they say that Harun was an individual among Bani Israel who was known among the Israelites to be very God-fearing and to be very righteous and pious, so much so that whenever they would want to praise a person for their piety or for their virtues, they would call that person, if they were a male, O brother of Harun, or O sister of Harun, if she was a female. Now, because this man became an icon and a symbol of purity and symbol of righteousness, they would connect a person who is righteous to that person. Just like among the Arabs, when they want to praise an Arab for their generosity, they say this person has the generosity of who? Hatim al-Ta'i. So as Hatim al-Ta'i was known and was an icon of generosity among the Arabs, Harun was a symbol and an icon for purity, modesty, and righteousness among the Bani Israel. So they say to her, O sister of Harun, your father was not an evil man, nor was your mother unchaste. Now, brothers and sisters, this hints to the importance of Isma and to the importance of our prophets being born from a pure descent. Many people say that, you know, Ibrahim alayhi salam, his father was a kafir. Because there are certain verses in the Holy Quran where Ibrahim addresses an individual and he addresses this person as, oh my father. But according to the school of Ahlul Bayt, that man wasn't the father of Ibrahim, but rather he was the uncle. We believe that all of the prophets of Allah, they come from a pure ancestry. They come from a pure line. And this in itself shows you, people, when they are confronted with certain situations, they automatically look at the father and the mother and the line of that person. So if a prophet has parents who are kuffar, or a prophet has parents who are away from the straight path, the people that they are preaching to will automatically criticize them for their origin. And this is why it's essential that a prophet has and comes from a pure line, a pure ancestry. As the Holy Quran says, speaking about the prophet, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَرَاكَ حِينَ تَقُومُ وَتَقَلُّبَكَ فِي السَّاجِدِينَ. Allah sees you when you rise up at night for prayer, and He also saw you when you were being transferred from the loins of your forefathers. And Allah describes His forefathers as being as-sajideen, those who prostrate to Allah, those who are monotheists. So in the line of the Prophet, if you go back to his ancestors, all of them were muwahideen, all of them were monotheists. Now, so as Maryam is being verbally admonished by Bani Israel, she remains silent. She remains faithful to her vow to fast from words. And all she does, as the Holy Quran says, فَأَشَارَتْ إِلَيْهِ. She points to this child that she has in her arms. They're telling her that, what is this? You're coming forward with something that's strange. Oh, sister of Harun, your father wasn't an evil man, nor was your mother unchaste. She doesn't reply to them. She just points at this infant child. And this, the fact that she doesn't reply to them, angers them even more. It enrages them. And they say to her, كَيْفَ قَالُوا كَيْفَ نُكَلِّمُ مَنْ كَانَ كَيْفَ نُكَلِّمُ مَنْ كَانَ فِي الْمَهْدِ صَبِيًّا. They reply to her as if she's mocking them. They're trying to say, are you mocking us? We're asking you questions. And you're pointing to this child? How can we speak to a child who is in the cradle? Now the commentators of the Holy Quran here, they say that Isa alayhi salam was never placed in a cradle. Why are the Bani Israel saying, how can we address a child who is in the cradle? Maryam is holding him in her arms. Why are they saying we cannot speak to a child who is in the Mahd? Mahd in the Arabic language means cradle. The Mufassirin of the Holy Quran, the commentators of the Holy Quran, when they examine this word, they go back to the origin of the word Mahd. They say that the word Mahd, nowadays, it is used to refer to a cradle, the bed that the child sleeps in. But if you go back to the origin of the word mahd, it refers to, as the experts in the Arabic language, they say, a mahd is interpreted as al-makanu alladhi yuhayyi'unahu lil-tifl. It is any place that is prepared for a newborn child. And this could be the arms of the mother, it could be a bed, or it could be any place. So the origin of the word mahd is anything that was prepared to hold or to bear a child. Now, after Maryam points to Isa alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here then manifests one of His miracles. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala empowers this young child to speak. He gives him the ability to speak. And here, when many people say, you know, how is it possible for a young child who is only maybe a few hours old to speak? We know that physiologically, they're not in a position where they're able to utter words. Only after many months or even a year or two, they're able to speak. How is it that Isa alayhi salam was able to speak when he's only a few hours old? Brothers and sisters, whenever we are faced with things that we cannot understand, we have to always go back to one verse in the Holy Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا أَمْرُهُ إِذَا أَرَادَ شَيْئًا أَن يَقُولَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He wills something, He says, be and it is.
For us, it's difficult to understand. But the one, brothers and sisters, who created this universe, who created you and I from one single cell, do you think it's difficult for him to give the power of speech to one of his chosen servants? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, then why are you not amazed at the fact that you were created from one drop? You are amazed that I gave the ability of speech to one of my chosen servants? So we always have to remind ourselves that this is the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if Allah wills something, it is as simple as issuing a command, or even easier than that. Now, in verse 30, we find that this child, who we know as Isa ibn Maryam, begins to speak. And look how beautiful the words are that he utters. He says, "Qala inni abdullah." I am the servant of Allah. I am the slave of Allah. You find, brothers and sisters, that, you know, ironically, this is a man who was attributed divinity. This is a man who people, even now, people even today, they say he is God. He is the son of God. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that you weren't there, O people. You weren't there when Maryam pointed to him. You weren't there. And the first words that this child uttered when he was presented before Bani Israel was that I am the slave of Allah. I am the servant of Allah. Many people nowadays, especially among the Christians, some of them they get offended if you say that Jesus was a slave of God. He was a servant of God. They get very agitated. They say, no, he was God or he was the son of God. But Allah in the Holy Quran, in another verse, he responds to this. He says, لَنْ يَسْتَنْكِفَ الْمَسِيحَ أَنْ يَكُونَ عَبْدًا لِلَّهِ. Isa alayhi salam was never ashamed to be a servant of Allah. He was honored to be the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, brothers and sisters, when we address our Holy Prophet in our prayers, what do we say? We say, Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. We say, أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. We say that we bear witness that Muhammad is what? Is the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And being a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, brothers and sisters, this is the highest position a human being can occupy. You may tell me, is it higher than Nubuwwah? And Risala, you have to understand, brothers and sisters, that the whole purpose of prophethood and the whole purpose of Allah sending messengers was for people to become servants of Allah. Was for people to become servants of Allah. It's narrated, brothers and sisters, that one day Salman al-Farisi and Bilal, they once came to greet the Prophet. And these are two men who had great love for the Prophet. They come to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, and Salman, because he loved the Prophet so much, he threw himself at the feet of the Prophet and he began kissing the feet of Rasulullah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, he moves his feet away and he asks Salman to rise. He tells Salman, Ya Salman, la tasna' bi ma tasna'u al-a'ajimu bi muluka. O Salman, do not treat me the same way people treat their kings. He says to Salman, O Salman, أنا عبد من عبيد الله. O Salman, I am a slave of the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet doesn't say, yes, kiss my feet because I'm a messenger or I'm a prophet of Allah. He says, do not treat me like this because I regard myself and I consider myself a slave of the slaves of Allah. أكل مما يأكل العبد. I eat of the same things that the slaves eat. وَأَقْعُدُ كَمَا يَقْعُدُ الْعَبْدِ. And I sit in the same way that a slave sits. Because the Prophet is always aware that there is one king in this universe, and that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That there is only one master in this cosmos, in this universe, and that is Allah. All of us are slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So then Isa alayhi salam, he says, I am the servant of Allah, آتاني الكتاب. Allah has given me and He has revealed to me the Injeel and He has made me a prophet. Why has He revealed to me the Injeel, the Gospel, and why has He made me a prophet? It's because I was an obedient servant. It's because I excelled in my ibadah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he says, وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُ. And Allah made me blessed wherever I may go. Now here's a question, brothers and sisters. What does it mean when Isa alayhi salam says, I am blessed, and Allah has made me blessed? Are there any ideas about what it means for Isa alayhi salam to say that Allah has made me blessed wherever I go? What does this mean? Any guesses? There's no punishment if you get it wrong. You can guess. When Jesus says, Allah has made me blessed wherever I go, what does it mean?
It means like this, God gave him a gift. He's blessed by God.
In what way is he blessed by Allah?
In eternity,
in belief. Ahsantum. It has many meanings, but one of the meanings that Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, he says, because we know when we want to understand the Quran, we have to go to the guardians of the Holy Quran. We have to go to the teachers of the Holy Quran. We have to go to the family where the Quran was revealed. The Quran was revealed in the homes of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, he says what Allah means by Mubarak here, to be blessed, it means to be an-nafa', to be beneficial and helpful to those who are around you. This shows you that Isa alayhi salam wasn't a human being who just lived for his own benefit. There are many people, they only live for themselves. They only do things if there's a benefit in it for themselves. Imam al-Sadiq says Allah made him blessed, meaning he was an individual who brought benefit, not only to himself, but to those who are around him. You know, we have a narration from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi where he says, مَنْ قَضَى لِأَخِيهِ حَاجَةً قَضَى اللَّهُ لَهُ بِهَا مِئَةِ أَلْفِ حَاجَةً إِحْدَاهُنَّ الْجَنَّةِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Holy Prophet says that if an individual fulfills one need for his Muslim brother or sister, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will fulfill 100,000 of his needs and requests, and one of those requests is paradise. One of them is Jannah. This shows you, brothers and sisters, how important it is for us to be helpful to other people, to go out of our way to assist our fellow human beings. And then Isa alayhi salam, he says, وَأَوْصَانِي بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ مَا دُمْتُ حَيَّا. And Allah enjoined what? He enjoined prayer and charity upon me for as long as I live. The commentators of the Quran, they say salah here and zakat here are not only referring to the prayers or the fasting. Salah here symbolizes and signifies the rights of Allah over the human being. And zakat signifies the rights of human beings over us. So salah signifies haqqullah, the right of Allah over you. And zakat signifies the rights, the huquq of the people around you. That to be a person who is truly close to Allah, to be a true servant of Allah, a true servant of Allah is one who fulfills the rights of Allah and also the rights of the human beings around him. And then Isa alayhi salam, he's describing his virtues and his merits. And then in verse 32 he says, وَبَرًّا بِوَالِدَتِي وَلَمْ يَجْعَلْنِي جَبَّارًا شَقِيًّا. And he says, Allah has made me dutiful and kind to my mother. This is a prophet who is describing his noble qualities. And one of his noble qualities that he found worthy of mention is that he says, Allah has made me kind and dutiful to my mother. You know, during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi, اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد.
There was once a man who came to the Prophet and he said, Ya Rasulullah, I wish to fight in jihad. I want to fight in the battlefield to defend the religion of Islam. And I want to be martyred so I can earn paradise. I want to fight jihad because I am yearning for paradise. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, he says that there is no jihad now. There is no immediate jihad for us to engage in. But he asks him, he says, do you have a mother who is still alive? He says, yes, my mother is still alive. He says, go to her, be kind to her, and kiss her feet, for Jannah is beneath the feet of your mother. He says, Al-Jannah tu tahta aqdam al-ummah. He says, you're desirous of Jannah. He says, you can taste Jannah on this earth. Go and be kind to your mother. Kiss the feet of your mother, for Allah Azza wa Jal has placed the paradise beneath the feet of the mother. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
And then Isa alayhi salam, what is he saying? He says, وَلَمْ يَجْعَلْنِي جَبَّارًا شَقِيًّا. What is the word jabbar? What is the translation that they've written for jabbar and shaqiyya? And he has not made me what?
Overbearing.
Overbearing and? Okay. Now what is the meaning of the word jabbar? See, with these English words, they're very limited in their meanings. If you look, yeah, I think one said insolent and wretched or unblessed. Now if you look at the word jabbar, Isa alayhi salam says, and I am not a jabbar. What is the meaning of the word jabbar? According to the commentators of the Holy Quran, someone who is jabbar is someone who feels that he has rights over people, but no one has any rights over him. Aggressive. Someone who is an aggressor. Someone who believes that everyone owes him, but he owes no one. That everyone must respect him. And he has rights over others, but no one has any rights over him. And it also refers to someone, according to the commentators of the Holy Quran, it refers to someone who, when he or she is angry, they oppress others. Or when he or she is angry, they kill other people. They have no respect for the sanctity of life. The only life that has value is their lives. It doesn't matter what's happening with the people around the world. As I said, the world revolves around this person, a very egocentric individual. And it also refers to someone who never consults his aql. This is someone who never uses his intellect. He is always being overpowered by his desires, by his animalistic desires, and he covers up his or her deficiencies by claiming to be great. There are those who achieve greatness because of their actions, and there are those who seek greatness by testifying for themselves that they are great, who only claim to be great. So this is the meaning of the word jabbar. What is the meaning of the word shaqi? Someone who is wretched. I think wretched is the most accurate translation. Someone who is shaqi, what does it mean? Someone who is shaqi is an individual who is self-destructive. Meaning what? Meaning this is a person who, again, doesn't utilize his intellect, doesn't accept advice from those who possess intellect. And Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, he has two ahadith, famous narrations, where he describes who the shaqi is. He says, "Inna shaqiya man hurima naf'a ma utiya min al-aql wa al-tajruba." He says, someone who is wretched is someone who does not benefit from his intellect or experience. There are those whose intellect may be weak, but there are some people, even though their intellect may be weak and underdeveloped, they learn from experience. Life teaches them lessons, and they learn the lessons of life. But someone who is wretched, someone who is a shaqi, he doesn't take lesson from his intellect, nor does he take lesson from his life experiences. Even experience doesn't shape him up. He doesn't take any lessons from that. And then the Imam alayhi salam, Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, was once asked, who is the most wretched of people? There is someone who is a shaqi, and then there is someone who is ashqa al-ashqiya, the most wretched of the wretched. The Imam alayhi salam, in a very beautiful way, he defines and he describes the person who is ashqa al-ashqiya. He says, "Man ba'a akhiratuhu bidunya ghayri." He says, the most wretched of the wretched is he who sells his akhirah, his hereafter, not for his dunya, but for the dunya of others. Just like the one, when Imam Zain al-Abidin, he enters the masjid, he hears a man cursing Ali ibn Abi Talib and the Ahlul Bayt. Why? So he can please Yazid. He sold his akhirah, not for himself, so he can satisfy another person, so he can satisfy the desires of another individual. He gives his akhirah for the dunya of others. And then, in verse 33, Isa alayhi salam, he says, وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيَّ يَوْمَ وَلِدْتُ وَيَوْمَ أَمُوتُ وَيَوْمَ أُبْعَثُ حَيَّ. And peace be upon me on the day when I am born, on the day that I was born, and on the day that I die, and on the day that I will be resurrected. And we spoke about why he chooses these three periods. It's because these three periods are the most difficult periods in the existence of the human being. And especially, brothers and sisters, the Day of Judgment. If I were to rank which of these periods is the most difficult, it is the day when we are resurrected for the Day of Judgment. And Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam, he says, O Allah, I seek refuge with you on the Day of Judgment. وَأَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنْ يَوْمٍ أَوَّلُهُ فَزَعْ وَأَوْسَطُهُ جَزَعْ وَآخِرُهُ وَجَعْ. O Allah, I seek refuge with you from a day whose beginning is fright and terror, and whose middle is anguish and sorrow, and whose end is pain. This is the Day of Judgment, brothers and sisters. The reason why our Imams speak like this, it's because they understand the reality of the Day of Judgment. And we'll conclude with this final narration, where Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, he says, one day Jibreel came to Isa alayhi salam, and Jesus alayhi salam, he asked the angel Jibreel, O Jibreel, mata qiyam as-sa'ah? O Jibreel, when is the Day of Judgment? Jesus, he's asking Jibreel, when is the Day of Judgment? Narration say, Imam Sadiq said, Jibreel began to tremble and Jibreel faints. When he becomes conscious again, he says, Ya Ruh Allah, O Spirit of Allah, مَنْ مَسْؤُولِ أَعْلَمُ بِهَا مِنَ السَّائِلِ. He says, O Isa, O Spirit of Allah, indeed the one who's asking this question, the one who is being asked this question, does not know more than the one who is asking. Meaning that I do not know more about it than you do. And he says, but I do know, Jibreel says, but there's one thing that I know. I know that وَلَهُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. I know that to Allah belongs everything in this universe. لَا تَأْتِيكُمْ إِلَّا بَغْتَةً. He says, there is one thing that I know about the Day of Judgment, and that is it will take everyone by surprise. No one will expect it. People will be very comfortable, but the Day of Judgment will come as a very severe surprise to the people. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us and to guide us and to illuminate our hearts with the teachings of the Holy Quran. We ask Allah to honor us with the ziyarah of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad in this life, and we ask Him to grant us the shafa'ah, the intercession of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad on the Day of Judgment. يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَا أَنِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ وَآلِهِ الطَّاهِرِينَ.